much time to make up your mind. Baby, you love me, or you don't. No, the other girls and your crazy mixed up world. You said you dropped them, but you know you won't. Sometimes I think about forgetting you, but it's so, so hard to make that choice. Seventh heaven, just by the sound of your voice.
Circles go round it. Circles
go round and round.
Circles go round it. Circles.
Welcome, family, to another episode of God's Glory and History. I'm your host, MC Enemy. It's spelled I-N-A-M-E because it's not about me. It's about the Word of God and His truth on this channel. Welcome to Sabbath Fellowship. This episode is scheduled to be aired Friday, March 10th, 2023. Yah is looking for people to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And on this channel, we focus on His truth and we let His truth set you free. Don't forget the prayer of Paul to the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 through 21. If you read it, it will bless you with understanding of God's word and His love for you. If you haven't done so yet or you're new to the channel, most important thing, download at least 2 Bible apps and follow along with us. And we ask that you make one of those Bible apps, the 1611 King James Bible with the Apocrypha. There are additional books in there that you cannot get in a standard 66 book version. That will bless you. And the reason why we say at least 2 Bible apps right in the middle of your screen, the facts of every case must be established by the testimony of 2 or 3 witnesses. Don't forget, family, like, comment, subscribe. But more importantly to me is that you share this with others. You never know who you might be leading to Christ. In case you missed it, we released 2 shorts, episode 147 and episode 148. It talked about why Moses committed murder and why or how did Moses get his speech impediment. Real short, about 5-6 minutes, and it will enlighten you. Today's episode, episode 149, Easter, also known as Ishtar, another doctrine of men. And as a subtitle, the root of Lent, since we are in the season of Lent. All right, brothers and sisters, let's get to work. So who decides when Easter is every year? In 325 CE, the Council of Nicaea established that Easter would be held on the first Sunday after the first full moon occurring on or after the vernal equinox. From that point forward, the Easter date depended on the ecclesiastical proclamation of March 21st for the vernal equinox. So that's how we get Easter. Now, Easter this year is going to be Sunday, April 9th, 2023. But to the right, on the right of your screen, you see I also have the Passover date. Now, Passover is an 8-day celebration, celebrated starting from April 5th, going through this year through April 13th. So if you notice, they cleverly placed Easter right there in the midst of Passover. Now, in episode 133, we discussed why not to celebrate Christmas, and Ishtar is no different. And right there, the reason for is 1611 King James Bible, Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 32. It is written, "What things soever I command you, observe to do it. Thou shalt not add thereto, nor diminish from it." So the feast days, aka holidays or holy days, that God has told us in His word in the Old Testament are the only ones that we should be observing today. It says, do not add to it and do not diminish from it. So is Passover and Easter the same? No, they're not. So published in March 26 of last year, Passover and Easter share many similarities as they occur during the same time of the year, and some aspects of their celebrations are similar. They are, however, fundamentally different holidays. Passover is a Yehudi holiday, whereas Easter is a quote-unquote Christian holiday. Amos 3:1-2. It is written, "Hear this word that Yah hath spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt, saying, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for all your iniquities." So you only, Israel only, is the family that he's known. And that's why when people are quote unquote saved, they become part of the family of Israel with all the rights and benefits. There's no difference between a Yehudi or a Gentile at that point. So it all starts with Father Abraham. 1611 Genesis 12:1-3. And you're going to notice that we're kind of working backwards here, right? But you'll see it. So it is written, "Now the Lord Yah has said unto Abram," that's before his name was changed, "get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make thee of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed." And that's because the Messiah will come through his bloodline. So that promise continues with Father Isaac. 1611 Genesis 17:19. It is written, "And Yah said, Sarah, thy wife, shall bear thee a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac. And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him." So now Isaac, if you know, had twins. He had Esau first, and he had Jacob, who had his name changed to Israel. So we know that it passed to Father Jacob. 1611 Genesis 25:23, it is written, and this is the Spirit of Yah speaking to Rebecca, I believe it is her name. I forget, there's so many women in my mind in the Bible, but I believe it's Rebecca. It is written, "And Yah said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger." Well, family, Jacob was the younger brother. His name was changed to Israel, and he received the blessing and the birthright over Esau. I'm not going to get into that story of how that happened and how it transpired. I've covered that before. So what is that blessing? Let's see. 1611 Genesis 27:28-29. It is written, "Therefore, Yah give thee of the dew of heaven and the fatness of the earth and plenty of corn and wine. Let people serve thee and nations bow down to thee. Be Lord over thy brethren and let thy mother's sons bow down to thee. Cursed be everyone that curseth thee, and blessed be he that blesseth thee." So there you can see that that promise, that original promise from Abraham being passed down to Israel, also known as Jacob. Just had a brain freeze right there for a second. So here we have the 40 days of Lent is rooted in the 40 years that they spent in the wilderness of the Exodus. So Lent is that solemn Christian religious observance and liturgical year commemorating the 40 days Jesus Christ spent fasting in the desert and enduring temptation by Satan, according to the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, before beginning his public ministry. And if you go all the way down to the bottom, it says it's related to Exodus. So let's tie things together. Like I said, you're going to see we're going to kind of be going backwards a little bit. All right. So 1611 King James Bible, Ezekiel chapter 4, verses 4 through 6, it is written, "Lie thou upon thy left side and lay the iniquity of the house of Israel upon it, according to the number of days that thou shalt lie upon it, thou shalt bear their iniquity. For I have laid upon thee the years of their iniquity, according to the number of the days, 390 days. So thou shalt bear the iniquity of the house of Israel." That's the northern kingdom. That's after the split. "And when thou have accomplished them, lie again on thy right side, and thou shalt bear the iniquity of the house of Judah 40 days. I have appointed thee each day for a year." So 40 years. Equates to 40 days. That's the 40 days that Christ spent in the wilderness fasting and praying. Equates to the 40 years that we wandered so far in the desert before going into the promised land. Let's look at the Exodus covenant. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 19, verse 3 through 8. It is written, "And Moses went up unto Yah, and Yah called unto him out of the mountain, saying, Thus thou shalt say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. Now, therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation." Excuse me. "And these are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. And Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before their faces all these words which Yah commanded him. And all the people answered together and said, all that Yah hath spoken, we will do. And Moses returned the word of the people unto Yah." So there, that is how we actually agreed to become his people. He does not force you to do anything. He doesn't want to force you. He can just destroy you if he wanted to. He wants you to choose him. Now, right after we chose to become his people, the complaints start rolling in because they're out there in the wilderness. So complaint number one, 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 15, verse 23 through 27. It is written, "And when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore, the name of it was called Marah. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? And he cried unto Yah, and Yah showed him a tree, which when he had cast it into the waters were made sweet. There he made them a statute and an ordinance, and there he proved them and said, if thou wilt diligently listen to my voice, or hearken to the voice of Yah thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes. I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am Yah that healeth thee. And they came to Elim, where 12 wells of water, where were 12 wells of water. I think that's a coincidence. 12 wells of water, 12 tribes of Israel, and 70 palm trees. And they encamped there by the waters. So basically an oasis. You got 12 wells of water and you got 70 palm trees. Give them some shade. Now, where he says, I am Yah that healeth, one of the names that he's called is Jehovah Rapha. And we're going to see what that means momentarily, but it's right there on your screen, the Lord that healeth. So, took care of the thirst, complaints start rolling in again, not long afterwards. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 16, verse 1 through 5, it is written, and they took their journey from Elim, and all the congregation of the children of Israel came unto the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the fifth day of the second month after their departing out of the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said unto them, would to Yah we had died by the hands of Yah in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full, for ye have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Then said Yah unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. And it shall come to pass that on the sixth day they shall prepare that which they bring in, and it shall be twice as much as they gathered daily. Why is that? Because on the seventh day he expected them to rest. Hint, hint, seventh day, rest. Also a holy convocation. That's a whole nother story. Not get into that. So beware who you complain against. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 16, verses 6 through 15. It is written, and Moses and Aaron said unto the children of Israel at the even, then ye shall know that Yah hath brought you out from the land of Egypt. And in the morning, then ye shall see the glory of Yah, for that he heareth your murmurings against Yah. And what are we that ye murmur against us? And Moses said, this shall be when Yah shall give you in the evening flesh to eat, and in the morning bread to the full, for that the Yah heareth your murmurings, which ye murmur against him. And what are we? Your murmurings are not against us, but against Yah. And Moses and Aaron spake unto the children of Moses spake unto Aaron, say unto all the congregation of the children of Israel, come near before Yah, for he hath heard your murmurings. And it came to pass, as Aaron spake unto the whole congregation of the children of Israel, that they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of Yah appeared in the cloud. And Yah spake unto Moses, saying, I have heard the murmurings of the children of Israel. Speak unto them, saying, at evening ye shall eat flesh, and in the morning ye shall be filled with bread, and ye shall know that I am Yah, your God. And it came to pass at that evening, the quail came up and covered the camp. And in the morning, the dew lay around about the host. And when the dew that lay was gone up, behold, upon the face of the wilderness, they'll lay a small round thing as small as the hoarfrost on the ground. And when the children of Israel saw it, they said one to another, "It is manna," for they wist not what it was. And Moses said unto them, "This is the bread which Yah have given you to eat." So he provided them meat, and he provided them bread. Already provided water before. But again, our complaints still roll in as they move on. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 through 7, it is written, "And all the congregation of the children journeyed from the wilderness of Sin, and after their journeys, according to the commandment of Yah, and pitched in Rephidim." Now, I'm going to pause for a second. Rephidim, if you don't know, is a location of where the Nephilim were living. Now, Nephilim are those hybrid humans and fallen angels, those beasts that come out of it, because angels are not supposed to lay with mankind. All right, so I'm going to move on. "And there was no water for the people to drink. Wherefore, the people did chide with Moses and said, 'Give us water that we may drink.' And Moses said unto them, 'Why chide with me, ye with me? Wherefore ye do you tempt Yah?' And the people thirsted there for water. And the people murmured against Moses and said, 'Wherefore is it that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst?' And Moses cried unto Yah, saying, 'What shall I do unto this people? They be almost ready to stone me.' And Yah said unto Moses, 'Go before the people, and take with thee of the elders of Israel, and thy rod, wherewith thou smotest the river. Take in thy hand and go. Behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, that the people may drink.' And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. And he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the chiding of the children of Israel, and because they tempted Yah, saying, 'Is Yah among us or not?'" Like I said, our ancestors were brought there to show them. They were already shown that he's going to provide them, you know, drink. He was already showed that he's going to provide them meat, and he's going to provide them with bread, and he provided them with shade when they needed it, and they still not convinced. So he brought them into this land here where the Nephilim are living. So he brought them to another test. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 17, verses 8 through 13. It is written, actually, I just have 8 through 10 at this point. It is written, "Then came Amalek," that's those same people, those Nephilim I told you about, "and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, 'Choose us out men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of Yah in my hand.' So Joshua did as Moses had said to him and fought with Amalek. And Moses and Aaron and Hur went up to the top of the hill." So now this test becomes a testimony. So as I was saying, that testimony, the test, becomes a testimony. 1611 King James Bible, continuing on with that Exodus chapter 17, continuing from verse 11. It is written, "And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed." Moses' hands were heavy, And they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hand, the one on the one side and the other on the other side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. And Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. As my pastor said, if you didn't say something then, you missed your shot. Because when his hands were held up, like our Messiah, hands were held up when he got the victory for us all, it's the same visual that he kept when Moses kept his hands up. We defeated Amalek. Continuing on, and Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. For he said, because Yah have sworn that the Yah will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. So that's not going to be the only battle that we're going to have with the forces of evil. We're still battling the forces of evil each and every day. So that Jehovah Nissi, it means the Lord or Yah is my banner. So you know how when you hold a flag up, like you're at the Olympics and you won and you're on the podium and you got the flag of your country, you holding it up. Yah is our flag. Yah is our banner. So let's look at the Mosaic Covenant. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 19, verses 3 through 8, it is written, and Moses went up unto Yah, and Yah called unto him out of the mountain, saying, thus thou shalt say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. And Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before their faces all these words which Yah commanded him. And all the people answered and said, all that the Lord Yah have spoken, we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto Yah. So there you go. That's how it came about. Now, I've said this word a couple of times now, the name of Yah as Jehovah. And I have to admit, I did not know that this was in the Bible. 1611 King James Bible, Exodus chapter 6, verse 2 and 3, it is written, and Yah spoke unto Moses and said unto him, I am the Lord, or I am Yah. And I appeared unto Abraham and unto Isaac and unto Jacob by the name of Yah Almighty, or God Almighty. But by my name, Jehovah, was I not known to them. So he's now revealing an actual name, right? Before Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, just know he was God Almighty or Yah Almighty. But now he says his name is Jehovah. Now I'm going to do a little research here into, so remember before 1611, there was no J. So anytime before that, which we know this is definitely well before that. And they wrote it in the 1611 King James Bible as I-E-H-O-V-A. So again, there's no J. So we know that the J is out. So what is Jehovah mean? So it says Jehovah is a Latinization of the Hebrew tetragrammaton, YHWH, and it says it's Yahweh. Is one vocalization of that tetragrammaton. The proper name of the God of Israel in the Hebrew Bible. So now it's pronounced. You see how they have those little symbols over the O and over the A? And you have to remember that the E sound has an, the E, written E, has an A type of sound in Latin. So I put the word there phonetically, what it actually sounds like. Yah-u-ah. Yahuwah. That is the name of the Father. Now, you can say Jehovah if you want. You know, you say it however you feel led. But just giving you a little bit of the background. So if I say Yahuwah, you guys should know that I'm saying Jehovah, that I'm saying Yah. I like to stick with just Yah because it's simple and it's the root of every name that he has. And it's a boss name too. When if somebody he just says, I am. That is a boss statement because he is a boss. He is the boss. So here's another one of those words. So God is not only our creator, but he is also our victory, our shepherd, our righteousness, our healer, holiness, and provider. So the name Yahuwah Shalom means God, our peace. And we talked about the other one before where I said Jehovah at that point in time, but now we know a little bit better. Yahuwah, Rapha, the God that heals. And then there's another one. They like to say, they say Jehovah, but Jireh, but Yahuwah, Jireh means Yah will provide. And it's one of the most popular names for the Most High. So he's our flag or banner, Nisi. He's our healer, Rapha. He's our provider, Jireh. Yah is truly our everything. So if you believe that he is our everything, you've already been forgiven, brothers and sisters. All you need to do is A, B, C. Accept the Messiah as your personal Savior. Believe he died for your sins and confess it with your mouth. Messiah said it best himself in Matthew chapter 12, verse 34. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So that means if you believe something, you truly believe something, you'll speak it. So I'm telling you today to pause the video and recite this simple prayer. Don't wait for tomorrow. Don't wait till you get yourself right. You get in where you fit in because tomorrow is not promised for you, to you. So go ahead and pause it and recite this video, this prayer. Now, if you recited this prayer with sincerity, and here's the kicker. Recited the prayer with sincerity and repentance in your heart. Let me be the first to welcome you to the family. Now, if you've accepted Christ today, please, please drop us a line in the comments that simply states, I'm in. That way we can celebrate with the angels for your arrival, with the angels for your arrival. Now, I know this is the beginning of your walk, but on this channel, we don't make orphans. So it's a three-step process to further your walk and continue to take those steps closer to our Creator. Step number one is to read your Bible daily. I know it's difficult. Got you covered. Go back to episode 62 entitled How to Read the Bible on this channel. It will help you. It will guide you. Step number two, find a Bible-based place to grow. This place must be one that's not stuck in the doctrines of men, which is what we were talking about at the beginning when you celebrate Easter. And then pray without ceasing. So bring all your cares and concerns and put them at, place them at the feet of the Father. And after you've done that, rinse and repeat. Go back to step number one. All right, so the various channels you can catch us on. Don't forget, like, comment, subscribe. More importantly, please, please share this with others. Time is precious. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for allowing me to do this study and share my information with you and grow in knowledge. And in turn, I pray that you grow in faith. Thanks for watching. I love you guys. And as always, worship the Father, praise the Son, and accept the Holy Spirit. May our Lord and Savior grant you his peace that surpasses all understanding. May it rest, rule, and abide with you, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen.